welcome to the Sunday School presentation for December 19th, 2021. Our theme for the winter quarter is Justice, Law, and History. And we are in Unit 1, which is entitled God Requires Justice. And today's lesson comes from Isaiah, the 9th chapter, the 2nd through the 7th verses. And it is entitled Justice and Righteousness Reign. Let's bow our heads, please, in a word of prayer. Lord God, on this final Sunday of Advent, this Sunday which highlights the theme of love, your unqualified, unprecedented, sacrificial love for us that allowed you to come to us in the form of Messiah, we pause at this time to look back at your word and to see how it was prophetically deemed that you would come to us, and that the purpose of your coming was revealed even centuries before Jesus came into the world. We ask your continued blessings upon this church, your continued blessings upon our community. As we deal with these new spikes in the coronavirus, we pray, dear God, that you would prevail upon the hearts and minds of the people of our community, that we would do the things necessary to eradicate this illness and bring us back to a sense of normalcy. We ask now that you would give relevance, meaning, and purpose to this study of your word. Let all that we say and do be pleasing in your sight and uplifting to your holy and righteous name. We ask it only in the name of Jesus, and for his sake we ask it all. Amen. Isaiah, the lesson that comes from Isaiah comes from that portion of Isaiah that is called First Isaiah. Some Bible scholars divide Isaiah into two sections. Others divide Isaiah into three sections. What we are clear on is that Isaiah is not a single work written by a single individual at a single point in time. But in broad strokes, Isaiah does have two general themes that we can hone in on. One has to do with the coming judgment of God because of the sin of his people, Judah, in the southern kingdom, and Israel in the northern kingdom. And the other theme is God's redemption that will come to us in the form of Messiah. It is the promise of hope that after judgment has passed and after discipline has been dispensed, that there will be a time of restoration and a time of wholeness. While you can see certain themes within the book and certain changes in thematic attitude, if you will, as you go through the book, you get sprinkles of both judgment and hope throughout the entirety of the work. We see that here in Isaiah chapter 9. The lesson, the printed lesson, starts with verse 2. Just for the sake of our discussion, I want us to go back and look at verse 1 and then read it within its context and continue. But there'll be no darkness for those who were in trouble. Earlier, he did bring the lands of Zebulun and Naphtali into disrepute, but the time is coming when he'll make the whole area glorious, the road along the sea, the country past the Jordan, international Galilee. The people who walked in darkness, that moves into our printed lesson, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. For those who lived in a land of deep shadows, light, sunbursts of light. You repopulated the nation. You expanded its joy. Oh, they're so glad in your presence. Festival joy. The joy of a great celebration, sharing rich gifts and warm greetings. The abuse of oppressors and cruelty of tyrants, all their whips and cudgels and curses is gone, done away with. A deliverance as surprising and sudden as Gideon's old victory over Midian. The boots of all those invading troops, along with their shirts soaked with innocent blood, will be piled in a heap and burned, a fire that will burn for days. For a child has been born for us. the gift of a son for us. He'll take over the running of the world. His names will be Amazing Counselor, Strong God, Eternal Father, Prince of Wholeness. His ruling authority will grow, and there'll be no limits to the wholeness he brings. He'll rule from the historic David throne over that promised kingdom. He'll put that kingdom on a firm footing and keep it going with fair dealing and right living. Beginning now and lasting always, the zeal of God of the angel armies will do all this. Isaiah's name means the Lord of Salvation, and it seems that the charge of the writers of Isaiah, whether we divide it into two large sections or three, was to turn the Jews to the Lord as the only hope of their salvation. There are two sub-themes, we mentioned that earlier, there are two sub-themes of the book that are significant. One has to do with the holiness of God. The fact that God is holy is mentioned 26 times in the book. And because God is holy, God establishes a standard of holiness for us. And when we fail to meet that standard, then we have to deal with the discipline that comes to us as a result. The second theme has to do with our humility before God. Isaiah calls those who do God's will his servants. He uses this term to describe Israel. He uses this term to describe God's prophets. He uses this term to describe Messiah, and he uses this term to describe the redeemed. Our text comes from that time just before the fall of the northern kingdom of Israel to the Assyrians. Judgment was unavoidable, and its extent would be massive. That's what he's talking about in chapters 8 and the first verse of chapter 9, when he talks about all of the darkness into which the people will walk. But after that, into this bleak scene, there is the promise of a Savior through whom God's people would know restoration and reconciliation. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. For those who lived in a land of deep shadows, light, sunbursts of light. The passage begins with the announcement of the change. There will be no more gloom for those in anguish. In the past, the Lord humbled the northern lands of Zebulun and Naphtali, which speak to the northern kingdom of Israel. But in the future, he will honor Galilee. That is where Messiah will first appear. Galilee, a place that was looked down upon as less spiritual and less pure than Judea. The explanation of this exaltation is found in this verse. The language is poetic. Darkness signifies adversity, despair, gloom, and evil. And the light signifies prosperity, peace, and joy. The language is used elsewhere of the Messianic age. It's found in Malachi 4 and 2. The Son of Righteousness will rise with healing in his wings. So the people in the north who have suffered so much have the prospect of a wonderful new beginning. Isaiah's verbs are in the past tense. He writes as though it has already happened. This is prophetic language. The prophet was a seer or a visionary. He received divine revelation and recorded what he saw. As far as he was concerned, if it had not been shown to him from God, it was as good as done. It was certain, even though it had not yet worked itself out in history. The initial fulfillment of this prophecy is clear.
Matthew quotes this text in conjunction with the beginning of Jesus' ministry in Galilee. Jesus is the true light of the world that lights every person. Jesus is the one that brings to a darkened world grace and truth. Jesus is the sure promise of peace. When he began to minister in Galilee with his teachings and his miracles, he demonstrated that he was indeed this promised Messiah. His proclamation of the kingdom through salvation is what ends the despair. For believers in him are not lost in gloom, but they know what he has promised and that it has come to pass. Verses 3-5, you repopulated the nation. You expanded its joy. Oh, they're so glad in your presence. Festival joy, the joy of a great celebration, sharing rich gifts and warm greetings, the abuse of oppressors and cruelty of tyrants. All their whips and cudgels and curses is gone, done away with, a deliverance as surprising and sudden as Gideon's old victory over Midian. The boots of all those invading troops, along with their shirts soaked with innocent blood, will be piled in a heap and burned, a fire that will burn for days. Isaiah now addresses the Lord directly. Instead of talking to the people or instead of talking about God, he turns his attention to God. His words explain what it means that light dispels darkness. He says, joy and prosperity will follow. He gives no clue to his readers as to how soon this would happen. But we who have the full revelation of God know that Jesus made it clear that he was Messiah, and that the age of peace and righteousness was ushered in with our submission to him. The joy that is described here is extravagant. Harvest was a regular time of joy in Israel. After a long time of labor in the fields, people would gather and they would keep what they have grown and they would eat and drink and celebrate. The Bible often uses the analogy of the harvest to describe the coming of the Lord. It is a Thanksgiving celebration for the completion of the harvest. Dividing the plunder, the other image here, is a bit more poignant. The image is about the victors after the battle is over, dividing up the spoils or the booty. Such would be an almost delirious celebration of triumph that would usher in an age of peace. The imagery of joy at the division of the plunder leads directly into the explanation Isaiah foresees the time coming when the Lord will break the oppression of the enemy. Because the enemy will be broken, Isaiah says that his people will enjoy joy, which is transcendent contentment with God, and prosperity, which is the provisions of all of God's people, whatever those needs might be, being met. Physical needs, emotional needs, spiritual needs, economic needs, social needs. That God is a God of the whole person. God is a God of the total individual. This victory will come with the presence of Messiah. Now, we have to be clear on the fact that Isaiah here is speaking in a twofold manner. Prophecy of a biblical sort has a dual meaning. There's always a meaning for the immediate time, and then there's a meaning for future generations. You and I live under the understanding of the future fulfillment of this prophecy. We know that it is fulfilled with the presence of Jesus. We don't know who Isaiah was talking about and what time he was talking about in the short term. This is particularly true when we look at the verses that follow, when he talks about a child being born and a son being given. But what we have to recognize is that whoever he was talking about in the short term, the main picture for us is in the long term, for it speaks to the coming of Christ. For a child has been born for us, the gift of a son for us. He'll take over the running of the world. His names will be Amazing Counselor, Strong God, Eternal Father, Prince of Wholeness. His ruling authority will grow, and there'll be no limits to the wholeness he brings. He'll rule from the historic David throne over that promised kingdom. He'll put that kingdom on a firm footing and keep it going with fair dealing and right living, beginning now and lasting always. The zeal of God of the angel armies will do all this. This is a remarkable picture. If peace is to come, then someone must have the ability to produce it and maintain it. That's what the prophetic word is about. That Messiah, the glorious King, will come. And he says that he will come as a child. Now, as I just mentioned, we can't know for certain to whom Isaiah is speaking of in his time. The prophecy is speaking of a child that was born in the immediate time of the writing of the prophecy. Some would say that that person would have been Josiah, who was considered to be the last great king and the last good king of Judah. But clearly, the ultimate meaning of this prophecy is a reference to Jesus, our Christ. And it is from that perspective, especially in this season of Advent, that we want to consider this description. Isaiah says that Messiah will be known by four titles. First, he will be known as Amazing Counselor. Justly, he's called amazing because he is both God and man. He's amazing because his love is the wonder of angels and glorified saints. In his birth, life, death, resurrection, and ascension, he is wonderful or amazing. He unveils to us secrets about ourselves, and he counsels us how to avoid the heartaches and problems that otherwise would beset us. He is the counselor, for he is intimately acquainted with the desires of God from eternity, and he gives counsel to us for our ultimate benefit. Second, he's called Strong God. Literally, the term is the Mighty One. As with wisdom, so he has strength. He can go through with his undertaking. He's able to do that which he comes to do. This unquestionably divine title can only describe God. And that's what we are told about Christ. Not just that he is a man that God uses, but that he is indeed God himself. In the beginning was the Word, John says. The Word was with God. The Word was God. And then he says in verse 12 of John chapter 1, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, or moved into the neighborhood. And so Strong God, or Mighty One, is an apt description of Messiah. Eternal Father. Literally, this is Father of Eternity. This is a reference to the fact that Jesus alone, Messiah alone, can give eternal life. It originates with him. He is the Father of the world to come. He was from eternity. We just quoted what John says about him. In the beginning was the Word. He was the Father of the great work of redemption. I have come that you might have life and have it to the full. In this world you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. He is the Father of eternity, for he ushers eternity into our presence and makes it possible for us to enjoy. Fourth, He is the Prince of Wholeness. Now, I know the King James Version uses the word peace. The Message Version translates this verse, Prince of Wholeness. If we understand divine peace as that which completes us, that which makes us whole, then we can be strengthened by this title. Messiah preserves the peace, commands peace, and creates peace. It is the wholeness that he provides that both keeps the hearts of his people and rules in them. We remind you that Jesus taught us that his peace, his wholeness, was different from the peace of the world. That's found in John chapter 14, verse 27. It is transcendent of our circumstances, for it is rooted in our relationship with him. Finally, the prophecy says that there shall be no end of the increase of this government, that it will continue to go, that it will radiate outward, that it will go on forever and ever and ever. Our assurance is that once we come into a relationship with God through his Christ, we have a perpetual blessing, not temporary, not circumstantial, not conditional, but a perpetual blessing that will be with us and carry us and sustain us for all time to come. It will usher us out of time and into eternity. It assures us that we have a place with God beyond the things of this world. We have a place with God that has been prepared for us to share eternity with him. This is the promise that this passage gives to us about the righteous reign of Messiah when he comes. It is an appropriate passage on this last Sunday of Advent to lift up, because Advent is the celebration of the coming of God to us. And we remind you that while God came to us in the form of Jesus as the baby born in Bethlehem, the promise that is given to us is that he will come again. If I go, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. That's why we lift up the idea of Advent more than Christmas. Christmas is a commercial celebration of the birth of Christ. Advent is a spiritual celebration of the coming of God. He came once, and the promise is that he is coming again. And we can rest in the security of that promise. Lord God, we thank you again for this time of sharing. We pray that what we have said and done here has been pleasing in your sight. Keep us ever in your care. Keep us mindful of the responsibilities that are ours to uplift your name and to model your behavior toward one another. And in so doing, we glorify you. We ask your blessings now on the worship that is to come. In the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. We'll see you at 11 o'clock.